And welcome to the Force and Destiny live stream. For everybody that's watching us on Twitch, my name is GM Matt. Today we're going to be playing through the Fantasy Flight game Star Wars Force and Destiny beginner game. I'll be using it, but doing it fairly straightforward, using some of the assets from the game. It's great fun. It's a great way to introduce yourself to the game, and I think you can pick it up on Amazon in your favorite game store just about anywhere, even right now. So before we get started, I'm going to give each of the players a chance to introduce themselves and tell us a little bit about the characters that they're playing, and we'll just go left to right on my screen. So that'll be Kaveri, Balandi, Tarrast, and then finally Sarinda.
Okay, cool. I guess that's me first.
That's you.
I'm playing Kaveri. I am like a heavy range character, and I think that I'm going to be doing most of the scouting. I don't know how in depth I should go.
If that's all you want to give, that's great. But if you want to talk a little bit more about it, that's fine too.
She is a female Togruta, which is the same race as Ahsoka Tano and the other character, I don't remember, from the animated show. And that's how I recognize the race. It took some researching.
Yeah, okay.
Sorry.
And I guess that's kind of it for now.
Okay.
Ooh,
all right.
Hi, I'm Christina. I'll be Balandi during this campaign. She was originally a healer on her home planet, and she had to be smuggled off for murder because she didn't want to be mended by Balandi. Sorry about my dog.
That's all right.
Yeah, I'm Zen. I'll be playing Tarrast Boon. He's a Keldorian sentinel. And basically, he's been on the run from the Empire for a while, jogging from planet to planet, exploring mysteries and such. And apparently, someone he used to go exploring with has contacted him, and he needs to find him because that guy's in trouble.
All right.
Okay, and then, oh, sorry.
It's you, yeah.
Okay, so my name is Astuneta. I'm going to be playing today Sarinda, which is a female human who grew up with apparently too many sisters and not enough space in his farmstead on planet of Stella. And he realized around when she was 18 that she was force sensitive by chance. She was exploring several caverns around her living area. And she found a very old alien within one of these weird caves around where she lived. And this alien was having kind of a very weird device that she couldn't recognize. She took it home and she said, okay, this is like interesting. I'm gonna see what I can find out of this. And apparently she's also very good fixing stuff. I mean, she has been helping a lot in her family machines, different machines and things like this. And she was able to fix this. And then all her family was like, wow, how did you do this? And the daughter that actually was a lightsaber. And she had to find somebody who could teach her how to use her powers. And here we are.
Right. And the device she found, by the way, was a lightsaber. I'm not sure if that was clear to people or not, but she found a lightsaber in a cave on her home planet. And each of these characters also has a connection to a mentor that that I think Zen mentioned, that her name is Hetha Romond. And it's actually this mentor that's what they all have in common. They don't actually know each other going into this, but they've been all drawn together now as a result of their relationship with her and a distress signal that she has sent to them. And with that, let's get things kicked off, moving on to the next page. This is opening crawl. Let's see if we can get some music going with it.
Nice.
Trumpets blare. Gotta love it.
Phenomenal.
Everybody pretty much got it?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. So we are going to move you over onto the planet Splinter. And there, if you'll look down in the bottom right-hand corner of your map, you'll see a character token that represents the party. All of you should have control of that as we move along through the game. I might also be moving you with that character token as well. If you look now on the upper left-hand portion of this same map, I'll reveal it for you now, you'll see the temple, which you've been able to spot from the air, which is the destination that your characters are trying to reach so that you can rescue your mentor. But right now, you find yourself standing at the base of a very steep slope that is made of stone. It kind of rises up. It has some snow. It has some ice on it. It's not particularly tall, but it's going to take some effort to exert yourselves and reach the top of this slope. You can see some trees that are growing up near it. Might be possible to climb up on one of those trees and leap across onto it. Might be possible to climb up it. There's also a pretty treacherous path. It might take some while, but there's a pretty treacherous path that you can take going around it as well. And what we're going to do to get the game started is each of you can pick a way you want to try to get past this slope, and then we're going to make a skill roll depending on the approach that you want your character to take. So questions about that, or does somebody want to go first?
Are they all of equal length?
Are what of equal length?
The different ways to get across.
The path around is longer. It looks more treacherous.
Is the wall also with the snow and ice, or is it just rocks?
There's some snow on it as well, and some rocks. A lot of rocks and a little bit of snow.
Okay, because I come from a planet that is not, you know, I'm not very used to climbing or doing things like this, so I think I would rather go through the path if you guys agree.
And you can try different ways if you want. I mean, different people can try different approaches as well.
I would prefer the not treacherous path.
So I guess, in what ways is it treacherous?
Yeah.
There looks to be a lot of loose ground. There's a lot of ice on it. It doesn't go straight up like a climb would, but you're going to have to struggle hard to get your footing, and you're going to have to exert a lot of effort to just kind of get up. It just kind of goes up and winds back around up at the top of the rise.
Doesn't that still sound easier than, like, leaping from trees, though?
I think so.
Yeah.
I'm with you, Caveria.
I would like to stick together. I don't think we should.
Yeah. Anyhow, Caveria, aren't you, like, a wilderness guide? So you should...
I mean, I can probably get into the trees, but I'm not sure about everyone else.
And you don't all have to do it the same way. I know somebody said they wanted to stick together, but you don't have to do it the same way.
Okay. So since I know that Kaveri is an expert in wilderness guide, I will do whatever she does. So, but they whispered, let's walk.
Can I take a moment to just kind of appraise the situation, see if there's like some way we could make this easier, maybe use some perception to figure out the best and worst ways to approach this?
Okay, you can make either a perception or a survival check. To make the check, what he's going to do is he's going to roll on the character sheet, he's going to roll one of those two skills, and then he's going to add two purple dice into it, which represent the difficulty. In this case, it's what's called an average difficulty. Okay. And so you go ahead and make that roll now. All right. So this is a two success perception roll by Terast. Terast is looking around, and after kind of surveying the situation a little bit better, Terast does see what looks to be a little bit easier path that can be taken to get on up the slope and get to the top of it.
Yeah, I think Terast points that out to the rest of the group, and he's like, I would suggest going this way. It seems much easier.
Sure. On this roll, Terast has rolled two successes. The net effect of it, there's a failure symbol there that's kind of an upside-down triangle. But he has two successes, and only one is needed to actually complete this particular test. So the party's taking the alternative path, I guess?
Okay, yeah. If you think it's a good one, let's go for it. I'm treading very carefully.
So the party goes ahead and makes its way up the path, gets up to the top of the steep, and once you get there, you've got a pretty clear vision of the temple in front of you. There's this long valley that leads between here and there, and you can see a bridge and then a narrow pathway that's going to kind of lead you on up in that direction. And it's probably going to take about an hour or so. That'd be your guess, hiking, unless you run into some kind of problems. But at about the time that you finally assist everything and had a chance to look around, you see a figure come out of the forest. And it looks something like this. There's this large orb-like device that's kind of hovering in the air, and then it's projecting something downward. And there's this ghostly figure of a species that you'd recognize as a Saurian. He has a very tall head, tends to have very long beards and eyebrows and things. He's wearing what appear to be some kind of ceremonial robes. And the orb just kind of floats up with him underneath it and comes very close to you. And in this silvery blue light, he says, "Hello, I'm the gatekeeper. Welcome to my valley. I'm impressed with the way you managed to handle that climb that you just made. But before I let you go any further, I need to know, what is your purpose here?"
Do I know, can I know if this is an AI, a robot, or is this a projection of a real person?
You can make a knowledge check. In this case, it's going to be knowledge lore. And this would be a hard one, which is going to be three purple dice.
I don't think I have knowledge lore, actually. No, I don't have it. Ah, sorry.
Yeah, it's on down the list.
Okay, so, and you said two purples?
Yes.
Okay. Knowledge lore. Okay, perfect. Dun-dun-dun.
Yes. Don't have the purples in there. You have to move your focus out of the box that has the purple dice in it before it'll include them in the pool. That's one of the weird things about this. So we're just do a reroll on that.
Sorry. Whoa.
So this roll is not successful. Those first two symbols are failure symbols, but you do get three advantage from that. Now, there's several different ways that you can spend advantage in this game. One of them is, if you can come up with a good explanation for it, you can give a boost die, which is a purple die, to the next skill check. Not a purple, a blue dice to the next skill check, which improves the chances of success or something good happening with somebody's next check. But Serinda kind of scratches her head, doesn't really recognize what this is. But there might be something good that could come from it.
Hmm. I think at this point, Terast is kind of just sitting back and studying the whatever's projecting this image. Okay. And
can I try to speak to the projection?
Yes.
Okay. What is your purpose for being here?
My purpose is to serve as a guardian of this temple that you see up above. And at the moment, I'm very concerned about what's going on up there.
Can you tell us what's happening?
Yes, there's a Devlin creature. You would all recognize Devlin creatures as being these red-faced creatures that have these two horns, look very devil-like. And you saw one in the cantina if you've seen episode 4. There was one of those in the cantina. There's a Devlin creature that's there, that he's a servant of the dark side, and he's corrupting this temple. This was a Jedi temple, and it's being corrupted by his presence. And I need him to be removed somehow.
And why didn't you stop this evil creature from coming to the temple? Aren't you the gatekeeper? Aren't you protecting this place?
He says, sadly, I do not have any kind of physical form in which I can manifest myself. I'm stored solely in an object called a holocron that's maintained in the temple. And this object here just allows me to project my image other places in the valley.
So how can we be of service to you? How can we help you with this devil creature?
He says, well, if you can make it through the valley between here and there, perhaps you can either force him to leave or destroy him so that we can restore the temple.
Apart from the Devlin, do any other dangers lie ahead?
Yes, there are several inhabitants of the valley that are have been stirred up by his presence that will probably give you trouble. And the trek up there is not going to be an easy one for you either.
Can you give us any piece of advice to go through the valley?
The only thing I can tell you is that you need to proceed with the utmost caution. I'll go along with you. I'll travel with you, but I won't be able to do anything other than communicate with you along the way.
That will suffice.
So can you tell me why you're here?
We are here because our mentor has been trapped apparently in the Mount Telek. My guess is the same place where this devilling creature is. It's called Ethan Rodbun Roman. Do you know him or her?
I know that the Devlin has a prisoner. I don't know, and I know it's a female human, but I don't know whether that's your person or not, the person you're looking for or not.
That must be it.
Do you know if there are any others here who can help us?
Unfortunately and sadly, no. There are only some very primitive creatures and humanoids that live between here and the temple. And if anything, they're going to be hostile to you because they've been stirred up by this person's presence.
What are you protecting, actually?
The temple includes some archives that hold some of the long-lost secrets of the Jedi, who, as you know, are now long extinct. The temple also includes my holocron, which is a very sophisticated embodiment of a person who was once a Jedi. It would not be a good thing for this to fall into anyone's hands. It needs to remain where it is, and its secrets need to be protected. These are not good times for these secrets to be revealed.
Then we must go ahead and save these secrets. I don't see any other way.
Yeah, I think Tarrasque looks around at the group and he says, well, our path seems clear. I suggest we get moving before anything worse happens.
I agree. If you see any, I speak to the gatekeeper. If you see any danger, can you alert us beforehand? Or
I'll certainly alert you to any danger that I become aware of, he says. So before we move on, I want somebody to make a charm check. And whoever, it just needs to be one person, but you all need to decide between yourselves who that's going to be. And we're going to see just how impressed the gatekeeper is with you right now based on this interaction.
I have 2 green.
I have 3 green.
I have only 2.
I'd say, since I want to protect this place, I would like to be the one making the roll.
Sure.
It's okay.
Go for it. Okay.
You're the one we blame when we fail. That's fine.
Yeah.
So this role is going to be comprised of 1 purple and 1 red. What you're doing is you're rolling an opposed check against the gatekeeper's skill that's known as cool. And I'm going to give you 1 boost die because you impressed him by making your way up the slope without needing having to go to a lot of effort. And then I'm going to give you another boost die because of the interactions that you've had with him. You've also managed to make a good impression with him on that. So it's going to be, you're going to add to your charm check 2 boost die and a purple and a red die.
Okay, and the boost dies, if I remember correctly, are
blue.
White.
Those are the blue ones.
Okay, perfect.
Yes, sir.
I got it. Okay. Ta-da.
Okay. So this is a successful check, very successful check, as a matter of fact. So you roll a yellow and 2 green for your charm. Very nice. So this is a very successful check. And some very good things happen as a result of it as well that you can select. You've got 3 advantage. However, you also rolled what's called a despair. That's the last symbol that's on this is a despair symbol. This despair symbol means that as the GM, I can select something pretty awful that happens at the same time. And so what's happening now, as he said, as he's talking about how impressed he is by you, his image is kind of fading in and out. He says, oh dear, and you start to hear a garbled sound. He says, I'm afraid my signal's getting weak. You may have to get through the first part of this trek without me. And then suddenly it disappears. And the orb is still kind of there, and it's hovering around following you, but his image is no longer present.
Oh, okay, so we move forward.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess Kaveri should be the first one, no? Since
yeah, I want to lead, and I want to. I think the best option for us is stealth, if that's possible. Because we're trying to get there as fast as we can, right? So by avoiding combat altogether, that'll get us there the fastest.
Okay.
Okay.
And I would prefer to avoid combat in general, so.
Okay. So you managed to make your way into the valley. You head across a bridge. You start around this path that you can see here, all the time trying to be as quiet as possible and stir up as little trouble as possible. And I'm kind of revealing the path slowly on the map. Eventually, you come to this ruin that is beside a very large lake. And I'll move you guys there as well. And what I'd like to get everyone to do now is to make a stealth check. And the difficulty on this stealth check is going to be 2 purple dice.
Okay.
So at least 2 of you have been successful on that stealth check. At least half of you have been. So you're going to come up on this scene in this ruin undetected. And what you see is there's a path that lies ahead of you that goes directly through a set of ruins. And there are these really primitive looking humanoids that are present here. I'm putting all of you on the board right now. You're able to kind of stay low, hide behind rocks and that sort of thing, but you can see about 5 of them total in front of you. And they look very, very agitated. They kind of push at each other. They don't seem very focused. They don't seem very purposeful. They look like they're a little bit crazy, to be honest. And unfortunately, you don't see much of a way to get through except by kind of crossing through this path that's going to take you straight by them.
Why not this one? Wait. How can I through here? Or we don't see that?
There's rocks, and the water is running too quickly, and there's a waterfall over here that is going to fall quite a distance. That you don't see much of a way to move forward without bringing yourselves to their attention.
All right, so we need this little rock thing here to cross this swiftly moving water.
Yeah, you might be able to wade through around in here and be okay, but this is really the best way through right here.
Okay. And what is this? Is this a cave or something?
Right here? There, it's a pit. It's a hole in the ground.
Okay. So they haven't seen us yet.
You're all lying prone. You're behind rocks and behind brush and that sort of thing, and you've just been observing them up to now.
So what do you guys want to do? Do you want to try to talk to them, or do they look pretty crazy? Can we have a more... Or they're just stressed or scared of something?
Okay, you went out for just a second. My screen froze up. Did anybody else do that?
No.
Okay, it was just me. So can you repeat that? That's good.
Yeah.
But can you repeat that?
Yeah, I just wanted to know if they are crazy, or because there is an influence on them, or if they are just afraid of something and that's why they look like this.
They appear to be... obviously, you've never spent any time around these primitives before, but they appear to be influenced by something that's driving them crazy.
Okay.
And not in a way that you expect them to be friendly.
Any ideas? Can anybody calm them down in any way?
Yes. Social skills, I don't think, are my particular forte, but
I was thinking of something more.
I can move a rock. That's about all I got.
What you're talking about is a force power that's called influence. I don't believe anybody has that force power in this group.
Damn it.
No, but I can tell you that they are angry. That is my force power.
Okay. Oh well. So okay, so I okay, so I guess if you all agree, I think we need to face these people somehow. We can try talking to them, see what happens, but I could be very prepared for fighting. So I don't know how I'm good at fight. You know, I've been brawling in my school with the people in my hometown, and I've been always getting into fights and things like that. So I'm okay fighting, but I want to know if you're okay fighting too.
I take out my laser rifle.
That's a good answer.
I would prefer to start talking first.
Yeah, we should at least give them the chance to not be murdered. That seems like a good thing to do.
I mean, if anybody of you can do it, I will back you up.
I'll wait here.
I'm going to hide behind a rock and start aiming, and give me a signal if things go bad.
Belandi, I can cover you if you want. I can go up.
What would I use to go talk to them out of curiosity?
How do you want to approach them?
With my hands in front of me, peacefully showing that I have no weapons, walking slowly, I guess. But what would I do then?
You're going to be making a charm check.
Okay.
Yeah, and I'm going to be next to her all the time.
Okay. So I can make a charm check just rolling these two, or do you want to add?
Yeah, you're going to roll charm, and then you're going to add two red dice to that pool.
Ugh.
I'm upgrading a difficulty on this check because of their particular condition.
Shall we position ourselves as we are before this happens?
Yes, you can position yourselves however you like before she steps out.
Let me know when to go, guys.
The map doesn't go far back enough. I'm sorry.
I'm going to be next to you, so you position yourself and I will just be next to you.
And can we say that I'm aiming at one of them? I guess the one she's talking to.
Yes, you can have an aim going in. Remind me when you fire that you've got that aim already.
Sure.
If you fire.
Right.
But what I just said doesn't bode well for you, does it?
It's not. Geez. Well, let's see the roll. All
right. Should I roll?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay.
Wow.
So this is the second despair that's been rolled in this game. And so she steps out. She holds her hands up. One of them immediately stands upright and starts screaming. And now they all start scrambling and drawing their weapons.
Great.
I will shoot.
So I'm going to pull the turn order up here. This normally we're going to do something called rolling initiative when we go into combat. But in this case, we're not. It's already established. We're going to do three PC slots, and then the NPCs are going to act. And then we're going to do another PC slot. And so three of you are going to have a chance to act before they open fire, but they are definitely going to be attacking you when their turn comes around.
Rats.
One quick question. What kind of weapons are they holding?
They are holding what are called slug throwers, which in our parlance is the equivalent of rifles, very crude rifles. Musket type things, maybe, is the way you could imagine it.
Okay. So I think you two guys should go first to shoot, and I will hold my ground here, protecting Belandi. Unless he wants to run, if that's okay too.
I want to fight too, but.
I think I should shoot first, right?
Yeah, I think you should shoot.
You two should.
Yeah, you hadn't queued up, so.
Yeah, okay. And then the third, either I go or Belandi just goes and hides or runs.
Okay. So do I just click the dice?
Okay, so you're already aiming, so you're going to add a boost die to your attack. And so you're going to, and Kaveri, from where are you? You're Kaveri, right? So which of these do you want to aim at?
I think probably the closest one.
This look okay. So we're going to put her at medium. We're going to put the hunter at medium range. That particular hunter at medium range. That is a medium range shot with a ranged weapon is going to be two difficulty. So you're going to roll two purple dice, and then you're going to roll one blue dice, which represents the aiming. And then you're going to roll the weapon on the weapon part of the sheet. You're going to roll for the weapon. Exactly. There you go. So your blaster rifle is going to do 9 damage, and then we add those two success results that you got in into the result as well. So it's going to do a total of 11 damage to that hunter. And let me check and make sure what happens to him here. Oh, yeah. So he immediately falls down after the shot.
Good job.
Good job.
And quiet down.
Booyah.
So now we've got another PC that has a chance to go.
Tarrasque, I guess?
Yeah, I guess I'll double move as far as I can, because I don't think I'm going to be able to close and attack in the same round here.
But I thought you had a ranged weapon.
You, if you wanted
I've got a blaster pistol, so I'm going to need to close.
So, okay. Yeah, you can you could maneuver into medium range and then use your blaster pistol if you wanted to. You just have to move a little bit further toward the hunters to do that.
Okay. So I guess I'll post up like right behind this thing. Is that close enough, far enough?
So you're trying to take cover as well at the end of your maneuver.
Yeah, okay. If I can.
Right. So you're now within medium range of that hunter. In fact, I'm going to say you're within short range of that hunter. So a short range shot is going to be one purple dice. So you're going to roll your weapon against one purple dice.
Okay, this is my blaster pistol. Let's see how it goes.
All right. So yeah. Taras, go ahead. One of the things that you roll there is what's called a threat. After your 3 success, you have a threat symbol. That threat you're going to take is strain, and so you're going to add 1 strain to your current level of strain. It should go from 0 to 1.
Okay.
And then this is 9 points of damage, which is just going to take this hunter out as well.
Yay.
I'm useful.
Yeah, that would be tough, actually. I thought it would be tougher.
I mean, these are laser weapons against primitives, you know.
So we got one more PC that can go now before the hunters act.
Belandi, I would prefer to not fight if at all possible, just because.
So if you want to go, if you want to retreat, if you want to use your turn to do though, or I can just go ahead and try to kill that hunter.
Can I reach it? Go ahead. Yeah.
Can I reach it with one movement?
So your surrender right here, you are moving to engage the hunter. Yes, you can use one maneuver to engage the hunter.
Can I at the same time draw my lightsaber and
Did you not already have it drawn?
No.
Okay, so then you can spend 2 strain to take an extra maneuver to draw the lightsaber. And then you get one maneuver to get within range of it. And then 2 strain to take a second maneuver to draw your lightsaber, and then you could attack.
Okay, so in that case, I will just move, withdraw the lightsaber, and just try to look very cool and try to scale.
Okay, all right. So Sarinda is going to move into range of the hunter, and she's going to draw and ignite her lightsaber and hope that just her presence there is going to affect him somehow or the other, which it does not, by the way.
But that looks so cool. Come on, lightsaber.
Caveman, no care for a fire sword.
All right. So the hunter is at least a little bit concerned about it. And so the first NPC action, this hunter's going to move back and get behind this rock. And then he's going to shoot at this strange person with the fire sword. And so here we go with his attack. He's a little bit spooked. He just can't get off a decent shot, and the shot just kind of cracks off the rock in front of Sarinda, and she gets hit by a couple of pieces of rock, but isn't damaged from it at all. And in the meantime, though, this hunter rolled an advantage on his check, and he's going to use that to give a boost dice to a medium range check that's going to get made by this hunter when he moves over in position over here. So he's going to fire at Tarrast, who is in cover over here. So his die roll, in addition to having two purples, is going to have a blue one, which is a boost die because of the advantage he got from the other hunter. And then it's going to have a black die, which is called a setback die, that is a result of the fact that Tarrast took cover before he made his attack a second ago. So here we go with this hunter's attack. Whoa!
Damn.
So the hunter is going to do 7 damage to Tarrast, but Tarrast should have some soak, and so you're going to reduce the damage that he takes of 7 by the amount of soak.
Where do I find soak?
Soak is
combat
up way up top toward the top of your character sheet.
Next to wounds.
Ah, 2. Okay, so I take 5.
Okay, so Tarrast is going to take 5 wounds.
It's okay. I've got a threshold of 11. It's all good here.
Then this final hunter is going to take 2 maneuvers, and he's going to kind of cross around through this stream and kind of take a position up behind this rock right here. But because he had to use a maneuver instead of an action, he's not going to be able to fire. And that brings us now to the last PC's slot. That should be Hubalandi, I think.
I don't want to hurt them.
Tarrast looks back. I just got shot. Take them out.
Now, okay. Bolandi can, as a combat action, attempt a heal if she wants to do that.
Can I do that? Can I heal Tarrast?
Yes. You're going to use a maneuver.
This is also acceptable.
To move into range of Tarrast. And then you can either use your force power, or you can just use a medicine check. Either way you want is okay.
I'll do a force power.
Okay, so you're just going to make sure your pool's clear, and then you're going to roll force die.
Okay.
So on her force die, she has rolled a light side point. She can spend that and heal 3 points of damage from Tarrast, just kind of holding her hand up next to him. Right, exactly. She heals him for 3 points.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And now we are back to the top of the turn order, and PC gets to take a slot now. It can be any one of you now. We're back where everybody's got potential for a turn.
This guy's in cover, right?
Yes, he is. They're all in. All 3 of them are in cover.
So my plan is to go out in front of this guy here and engage.
Wait.
I can't wait if you want to shoot first.
Well, I think that... So this guy's in cover, but that cover should only be respective to one of us. Right? Mm-hmm. So, like, if Sarinda approaches from the south, it should either be cover against Sarinda from the south or me from the east.
There's some rock formations here between he and Sarinda that are protecting him from Sarinda's position as well.
Okay. So, like, how can he approach?
But Sarinda's a melee combatant anyway. I mean, she's not going to attack him that way anyway.
No. So, Tarrast, do you want to do something first? Maybe take cover and shoot from cover?
Well, I'm in cover currently. So yeah, I'll shoot at the closest one, I guess. I guess that would be this guy.
Okay. So he's in cover, so you're going to add a setback die to your shot. It's going to be two purples. If you want to, since you're not moving, you could use a maneuver to aim, which gives you a boost die.
I'll aim and shoot. Okay. Yeah. Boost that up. And see what happens.
Wow.
Well, okay. That's good.
Okay. So that's 9 points, which takes that hunter out. You all are getting some good shots off.
Is it two advantage to lose a strain?
One advantage to lose a strain. You can spend one of those advantages to lose a strain, and then you've still got two more to spend.
Yep. What else only takes one? I'll probably pass one along to the next person to kind of counteract that cover.
Pass it to Kaveri, maybe.
Well, it just goes to the next person.
Yeah.
Or I could perform a free maneuver. No, I'll just pass one along. Take these guys out quick.
All right. So this shot's really impressive. It kind of distracts the other two hunters, makes them a little more vulnerable to the next shot. And we got another PC's turn now.
Kaveri?
Sure. Is it more beneficial if I close the gap or if I take aim?
You could try move. If you close the gap, you could come out of cover and you would decrease the difficulty from two purple, which is average, to one purple, which is easy. You could also maneuver in a place where he doesn't have any cover if you wanted to. Like, I'm thinking, like, if you wanted to maneuver over here, you could be in a position where he would no longer have cover from where you're located.
Yeah, sure. Let's do that.
Okay. So that's your maneuver, and now you've got one purple dice, and that's it. That's all you're rolling against on this one.
I have the advantage, right?
Yes, you do.
Do I need to add a dice for that?
Yes, add a boost die for that. I apologize, yes.
That's the blue, right? I don't think it matters. I'll just pass the advantage on. And
all right. So that takes out the hunter. That shot takes out the hunter.
Wow.
There's one of them left. He's going to turn and start running away. It's clear he doesn't want to have any more of this.
Wait, don't we have another turn?
Go first.
You have another turn if you want to attack him, but he's going to run.
I stand down. Fine. Let him go, no?
Yeah, he'll warn the others to stay out of our way.
Okay. I'm good to go.
Okay. So you're going to let him go then?
Mm-hmm.
All right. All right, so I'm going to take us back out of combat now, and the hunter is gone. And about this time, the globe, that's orb that's floating around you, kind of comes back on, and he says, very good. It looks like you managed to take care of the hunters without killing all of them. I appreciate that. I sadly was not here to explain it to you, but these are actually very friendly creatures normally that have been corrupted by this presence in the temple. And hopefully what you did will be enough to keep them away from you from here on out. With a minimum of loss. And incidentally, just because in this game, just because a creature goes down, it simply means it's been defeated. It doesn't necessarily mean it's been killed. So you could have survivors amongst them from this in the game. It's not necessarily true that all these hunters have been killed. They've just been taken out where they can no longer affect the combat.
So, okay, can I take all their weapons?
Yes, you can, but it'd be hard to carry them. If you want to destroy them or something so they can't.
I'll throw them
back
off the waterfall.
Yeah, okay. So Kaveri takes them all and throws them off the waterfall.
Very good. So what's this? Is this a cave?
Where's that? Right there, left. Yes. Yes, it is. It's a cave.
And the path continues here, or
the path? The cave? The path continues on this way.
Huh. So do you reckon the cave is where they live?
Are you asking us or the...
I'm asking Kaveri. You probably know more about this.
Can I... So one of my force powers is the ability to sense all things within a short range. Would I be able to like get a sense of most of the cave?
If you move to the entrance of the cave, what you would be able to do is sense whether there are any living things within short range inside the cave.
Okay. I guess, are you curious enough that I should move closer to where possibly, like, a Sarlacc lives?
Terrasse has the... Keldors can see in the dark, right? Is that a thing?
If it's on the character sheet, it is.
Okay, I just remember from reading it in the book. I ignore setback die for darkness.
Okay, we'll go ahead and play with the book rules on that race. I'm not sure I'm seeing it on his sheet, but on this beginner game sheet, but that's fine.
Okay, so yeah, Terrasse will like just take a look down into the cave from like here.
Yeah, and what you can see are kind of an assortment of very primitive tools and some bones lying around, just evidence that maybe these hunters had taken up residence in this cave. You don't see anything moving, of consequence at least.
I'll relay that back. It appears that they do at least store their things here.
Okay. So no need to go in, I guess.
Yeah, I think that we should probably just proceed.
Yeah.
So we're going to go back onto the valley map now, and you're going to continue to move forward down the path. Heads up this way, kind of around a bit of a cliff face that goes down toward the lake, continuing to move upwards all the time. And as you come through this area, you find yourselves all suddenly kind of losing you're going through some melted ice that's really, really slick, and you find yourself losing your footing, and sort of slowly, one by one, you start kind of falling downward into this indentation until you've slid down into the bottom of a pit. And there's a wall of just really slick melted ice that's right in front of you that rises on up. The guardian comes and he kind of hovers around the edge of the pit and says, "Oh dear, looks like you've gotten yourselves into a bit of a problem here. Probably the skills that you used to get up the rock face earlier are not going to work for you here. You're probably going to need the aid of the force to get out of this pit." As you look around, you do notice, among other things, that somebody else apparently has used a rope to climb up earlier, but that rope is like helplessly out of reach. There's no way you could reach it. And the gatekeeper just kind of stands there with his arms crossed, kind of observing, waiting to see, kind of thoughtfully, like, what will they do next? Will they know how to deal with this situation?
I can move small objects. I don't think that's going to help.
I can move something, too. You move it one space, I'll move it the other.
Yeah, I can jump. So I'm well. Can I...
The rope is small enough you could try to move it and jar it loose.
I'm also wondering, can I jump?
Okay. Do you have the enhanced force power?
I do. That's why I'm asking.
Okay. Yes, you can attempt an enhance check. What you do is you're going to roll that... clear your dice pool and then roll... that force power.
Okay. Combat. Wish me luck. Whoa.
Oh, nice.
So Sarinda manages to bend down and just this superhuman leap. She jumps up and lands on the top of the pit.
Hooray. Bye, guys.
Great for you. Nice meeting you. Good work nice for the rest you. Of us.
Can I look around? Do I see more rope or anything to use?
Yeah, you see the place where the rope that's dangling over the pit is kind of tied on to a log or something like that. That's for somebody that's been there before.
Hmm. Can I unknot it and make it longer so they can climb? Or there's no way?
It's kind of tangled up around some brush up at the top. You can see now. Okay. You might be able to reach over and kind of get it, shake it loose. You might also fall back in if you do that.
I do it very carefully.
Now, Tarast a minute ago suggested his move power. He can move a small object like a rope if he wants to attempt to pull it down himself.
Can you do this?
I can try, although... knowing my luck, the dark side will rear its ugly head. So clear the force pool and or clear the pool and just roll the power, right?
Yeah, clear the pool, roll the power.
Okay. Here we go. Nope.
There you go.
Wow. Light nice. Side all the way.
And so you kind of pull and tug at it, and it just kind of slowly comes unraveled until it finally drops down, where it's within easy reach of everyone.
Good. Do you guys
someone help me up this thing, because I'm not I'm a book guy. I'm not a, can I help not a climby guy.
Can I try to build you up it?
We've got a couple of options now. Sarinda can try to pull you up one at a time. You can try to climb it. It's going to be an easy check, just one purple die, and you can either use athletics or coordination for that roll.
Can I help the others? Because I have pretty good coordination.
Yes. Yes, you can provide. You can wait at the bottom and provide a boost die for the other two if they go first.
Yeah,
that would be greatly appreciated.
So that's just Kaveri kind of grabbing their feet or thighs or whatever and helping to push them up while they're climbing.
So what is better odds, a one yellow die or three green die?
Probably three green is a little bit better for you.
Okay. I'll just use coordination then.
Okay.
And what was the pool on this?
The pool is one purple. That's it. And you get your boost from Kaveri.
Okay. Awesome. Balandi, you want to go first? I'll catch you if you fall. Pay you back that heal.
That's very sweet of you. Thank you. Sure, I'll go first. Do I roll coordination?
You're going to roll coordination, and you're going to roll one purple and one blue die with it. All right, so Balandi manages to scramble up the rope. Actually, she could have done it on her own. If you look at that boost die, it didn't give her anything. But Balandi manages to scramble up the rope fine, and she actually has a couple of advantage that... she can spend if she wants to once she gets to the top.
Okay. What are those?
You could do things like you could lend another boost die to the next person that comes up. Maybe you help to identify a place where you can get some footing while you're climbing. That would be one way that you could spend it. But you can spend it in other creative ways if you want to as well. Just something that's a minor benefit, kind of like that.
Okay. I'll wait to spend it on... I'll spend it on Tarast, and I'll reach my hand down over the edge to try to help pull him up.
Okay. All right. So Tarast gets two boost die, one coming from below and one coming from above.
I like this. This is teamwork. Thanks, guys. All right. That's a lot of advantage. I like it.
Tarast makes it as well and has some advantage he can spend here.
Well, I'll definitely pass one along. I don't have any strain to heal. Let's see, I got three more to go. Let me look at that handout again. Yeah, I guess I'll just pass one along and help pull up Kaveri.
Okay. And Kaveri's mated already, it looks like. So now all of you've made it to the top of the pit. The gatekeeper continues to hover around you as you all kind of scramble and make your way up. And he says, very, very impressive. You've demonstrated very good control of your powers and the ability to work together. I think you just might have a chance at removing Malifax from the temple.
You'd have a better chance if you warned us of ice pits in the future before we walked into them. Thank you.
All right, so typically in this game, what would happen is you would not get any experience points to spend until the end of the game. But in this particular situation, you're going to get some at the end of the session, I should say. But in this particular session, you're going to get some experience points to spend in mid-session. If you look on your screen, on your what do they call that, the character tab, you'll see a handout that says leveling up your character.
Yeah.
Oh, in the journal. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, in the journal. Thank you. And then each of you should have a description of a way that you can spend experience points to level up for your character within that journal. You have a total of 10 points to spend, so you can either spend two sets of five or you can spend one 10 point. And I'll give you all a second to look that over. And then once you've decided what you want to do, we'll just kind of go one at a time and let you announce what decision you've made.
The parry talent and the reflect is a maneuver.
The parry and reflect are actually reactions. You don't have to spend a maneuver or an action on it. If you are attacked by a melee attack, the parry talent, you can apply it anytime you want to. You just spend the strain and you reduce the damage. And the reflect is the same way.
Okay. So I think I will get both of them.
Okay. Okay. So Sarinda is going to acquire two talents. One of them is going to allow her to take some strain to parry a melee attack and reduce the damage on it. The other is going to allow her to take some strain to reflect back a ranged shot that's made at her so that the damage from that shot is also reduced.
Okay. Can I add them directly on my character sheet already?
Yes, you can put them down in the talents area if you want to.
Okay, perfect. One, I guess, or zero.
Okay, and I lost the audio for just a second. So what did you say?
And I will get rank one on them.
Yes, rank one on each of them, yes. Anybody else? Go ahead.
Yeah. I'm going to upgrade my ranged attack to rank 2.
Okay. And that's 10 XP. If it's a career skill, which this would be for Kaveri, then you're going to spend 5 for each rank. So if you're going to rank 2, you're going to spend a total of 10 points on that.
Sorry, what did he get? I cut out for a second.
He increased his ranged attack ability to 2. He has one, right now he has a proficiency of 1. Now he's going to have a proficiency of 2. That's going to allow him to substitute a yellow die for a green die in his dice pool, an additional yellow die for a green die in his dice pool, which increases his chances of success and also increases his chances of getting what's called a triumph. You all haven't rolled those yet. You've been masters at rolling despairs, which are bad things. You haven't rolled any triumphs yet, though, but we'll talk about it if you ever get one.
At least we're good at being terrible. That's we're good at something. I think I'm going to upgrade my stealth skill and take the parry talent.
Okay.
Interest.
Okay.
I think I'm going to add a control upgrade to my heal power. Increase my charm skill to rank 1.
To increase which skill?
Charm.
Okay.
Skill.
And is anybody having any problems knowing how to increase your ranks and make that work on your character sheet?
You just put it to one.
Right.
Is there anything I need to do for the control upgrade?
You can make a note of it on the force power if you want to. Just make a note of it in the description of the force power, what the control upgrade does. In the main game, there are ways to spend these points that are a lot more flexible than this anytime you're awarded XP at the end of a session. All right, the next concept that we're going to talk about, which we talked about in chat just a minute ago, is the concept of a destiny pool. If you look on your character sheet up toward the top of the sheet, you'll see a section that's called destiny pool. What happens is when you hit the roll destiny button there, it will roll one force die for you, and then it'll put that into a pool that will be comprised of light side and dark side points. Everybody go ahead and do that. Just hit the roll destiny button one time apiece.
Sorry.
Okay, so I roll...
Click the roll destiny button under destiny pool. There you go.
Done.
All right. So, let's see here. All right, so our pool now has 9 light side points and 8 dark side points in it. Well, I didn't clear the pool before we rolled. So, hang on. We're going to have to do this again, guys. We're going to have to start this over. All right, I'm going to clear the pool out. Okay, now go ahead and roll the destiny pool again.
Hey!
Okay.
Yeah, of course.
It's better than last time. We're still good.
So this destiny pool has 5 light side points and 1 dark side point. You can, whenever you want to, you can spend a light side point, and there's several different ways that you can spend light side points. One of them is you can do it to what's called upgrade a check if you're making a skill check. What that does generally is it substitutes another yellow dice for a green dice, increasing the chances of success on the check. Another thing that you can do with it is you can use it to you can use it when you make a roll to just generally make something. I'm sorry, I'm confusing that with triumph. You can also spend it if there's some environmental element or some narrative element that you want to change that's not too game-breaking, you can spend a destiny point to create, you know, some cover for yourself, or to say, oh yeah, by the way, I did bring that med kit that I forgot. I sure do remember bringing that for sure, and you spend the destiny point to get it. I can spend destiny points generally to make life more difficult for you whenever I want to. But right now I've only got one to spend. You've got 5. But I encourage you to spend those liberally. It's kind of in the spirit of the game to try to use those whenever you come up with an awesome idea for something, or just want a little bit of an extra boost on your check to make your check improve the chances of your check. So don't forget, you've got the destiny pool that's available to you now. All right, are we ready to move forward?
Yep.
Yes. All right.
So moving forward around, now getting very close to the mountain, you come up to a bridge. And you're able to remain in cover far enough away where you're not spotted. But you can see these small reddish creatures that kind of jump around and make a lot of noise. There's 2 of them on one side of the bridge. There's 2 of them on the other side of the bridge. And the gatekeeper hovers up beside you, and he says, yes, these are the Advozae. They're being used by Malifax to help protect the temple. They've probably been instructed not to allow anyone to cross this bridge or to enter into the temple. And while y'all are talking about what you want to do next, I'm going to get everybody on the board here.
Can I ask the gatekeeper if these creatures are evil or they were corrupted? Or
he says, yes, just like the hunters, these creatures are corrupted. And you can expect... Well, no, actually, that's not what he says. He says, no, they are not corrupted in the same way. It might be possible to influence them in a way that you weren't able to with the hunters.
Okay. So maybe, Belandi, this is your chance.
So, same plan as last time?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Diplomacy the ugly creatures.
Maybe, yeah, let's hope for a high roll. Oh, no, we're not fighting yet.
Kaveri, do you...
No, you're not. I'm sorry. I'm just clearing out the turn
order. You're scaring me, man.
I didn't need to make anybody nervous there. Sorry about that. I was just clearing out the turn order.
Okay. Kaveri, do you and I want to sneak up so we can have a decent position if things go bad?
Yeah, maybe one on each side. Yeah. You're closer range, right? So maybe it makes sense for you to take the north way and me to take the south?
Sure.
Okay. So what you're going to do is you're going to make a stealth roll against their discipline, which is just one purple. I'm sorry, against their vigilance, which is just one red. And you're going to get two boost die because they have no idea you're there, and they're not really looking for people to be hiding around inside the woods. So it'll be one red and two blue. Oh, my gosh. Geez.
Wow.
Well, take a plus one or a boost.
Yeah, so okay. You take a boost on the other stealth roll.
Nice. All right, where did stealth go? There it is.
Well. So you guys have a lot of advantage if you can think of anything you want to spend it on.
The talking, right?
That'd be great.
We can also do something... where was it? Spending advantage. You can spend three to negate enemies' defenses. You can ignore penalizing environmental effects. You can have the attack disable the opponent or one piece of gear. You know, there's a bunch of stuff that we could... There's a plus one melee or ranged defense that we could drop on ourselves, I think.
So we've
got a bunch of options.
Yes, and if it gets into a combat situation, I'll let you spend those boosts in that way. Just you managed to find really good positions on top of managing to remain concealed.
Okay. Right, yeah, I think we'll just pass the advantage along and Just so it said, weapon at the ready and aiming at the closest one for Travis.
Yep, me too.
Okay. Yeah. I'm not going to screw you over on something like that. If you've told me you're in the forest and waiting to go for these guys, I'm not going to say, well, you didn't say you weren't aiming, so no boost die. I'm not going to do that to you. Okay. So Belandi's on stage now.
All right, so similar movement as last time, hands out, trying to show that I'm being peaceful. Oh, I move myself. And I guess I roll a charm.
Wait, Saranda, maybe have lightsaber in hand this time. Doesn't need to be activated, but...
Yeah, just have it. I guess you could have it in hand, but I want to show that I'm not carrying my weapons with me right now.
Okay. Okay, so they're kind of... They're kind of... bobbing up and down and kind of looking at you like saying, who are you? What do you want?
Sorry, I have a cat.
That's all right.
You have an adversary right there.
There he is trying to talk to you.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to talk with you peacefully. Please, can we just talk? Can I say that and roll for charm?
You don't have to make your charm roll yet. They're waiting for your pitch. But yes, you can walk up to them and talk to them peacefully.
Right.
Initially, at least.
All right. If you could please just let us cross through here. We don't mean any trouble. We just need to get to the top of Mount Talak.
They say Malifax gave us very specific instructions not to allow anyone to come across the bridge. Why do you need to be up there?
Oh, great. Anybody have any ideas before I say something?
Yeah.
We'll get a shot.
Tell them that we're also working for them.
Oh, okay. We also work for Malifax. Please, can we just walk by?
Okay, so this is going to be a deception skill check.
All right.
And this is going to be against their willpower, which is one purple.
Okay.
Their discipline skill. Because of the advantage that were rolled, everything has just been so peaceful, and they don't suspect anything because the trees around them just seem so, they resonate with peacefulness because of how cleverly they snuck into the woods there. You're going to add one boost to that check as well.
Okay.
They're not suspicious at all.
Right. Deception?
Yes.
Shouldn't it be two boost total then?
Oh.
Yeah. So you can re-roll it with two boost.
Great.
There you go.
So you've got some advantage that you can spend on that too, but they say, okay, very well, you may pass, and they kind of step aside.
Yay.
Now, are they going to be all crazy when two more people come out of the woods?
Oh, can I use my advantage to just say the rest of my party is behind me?
Yes, you can use your advantage to kind of explain away these people that are stepping out of the woods all of a sudden. All
right, that's what I'll do. So, and my rest of my party is joining us.
Okay. All right, so you manage to talk your way past the mercenaries, and the gatekeeper doesn't hang around while you're doing that, but he kind of meets you on the other side when... they can't see you any longer, and he says, again, I'm very impressed with your ability to resolve that encounter peacefully, though I'm afraid what lies ahead you may not be able to resolve in a similar manner.
We'll see.
Let's get out of here before they change their minds.
So there's a stairway that you can see right here that you start making your way up. You're getting very close to the temple now. It leads on to a path that goes up through some rocky terrain right here. And eventually you manage to come out. It's actually going to be in a cave that's right here that comes out. It's actually a cave that goes into the cliff face here and then comes out right here. And now you find yourself in the temple. And by the way, the beginner game has some very beautiful maps. This is one of which is one of the maps that comes with the beginner game. Another reason I highly recommend you buy it. Nice counters, some things like that. And you make your way along the path. You may want to zoom out to kind of get a big picture here, because you're actually going to end up landing at the top of these stairs right here. Which is on the far right-hand side on the middle of this particular map. And I'll start putting you guys in on it so you can kind of get a feel for where you're located now.
Trask looks at the gatekeeper and says, you know, when these Jedi build these temples, don't they, you know, want people to come there? I mean, this is kind of a ridiculous hike to have to get all the way up to this temple.
Like, there's always a landing pad, and we were just really dumb and didn't use it.
he says, only the worthy may enter the temple. You should count it an honor that you're here with my blessing.
Well, I'm honored. I'm also winded. And that's a problem.
and as you reach the top of the steps, before they can spot you, you see three wolves that are kind of basking out in the sun, sitting in the entryway to the temple. And like as I said, they don't see you yet. They're just kind of sitting there, lying on the ground in various poses, taking it easy. But they don't look like they're going to be very friendly if you approach them.
Blondie, I'm sure you could talk your way past these wolves.
I wish.
So I asked the gatekeeper, are these creatures also corrupted or not?
Or like pets?
These creatures, exactly, he says, they're more like pets. They've been trained to guard and protect the temple by Malifax.
Oh.
Well, they're evil foo dogs.
So that means we have to fight.
Anybody got any jerky in their inventory? We can get past this real quick.
We can spend a destiny point.
Can we please?
True. We could do that.
You can, if you want to try to create, a distraction that kind of keeps them occupied for a second, gives you a little bit of an advantage by spending a destiny point and having some jerky available, you can do that.
Why not use the force power to move objects to make them feel there are sounds somewhere else? You know, move some rocks.
You could do that, but you can only use, I think the move powers that exist can only be used within short range. And so you wouldn't be able to move much of anything except things that are actually closer to you.
Yeah, I think we destiny point a distraction, just like a nice leg of mutton that someone happened to carry along.
Maybe they'll find each other for it.
Yeah, we toss it like right back here.
No, we toss it right, like, exactly in the middle of all three of them.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure. So yeah, I'll spend a destiny point.
Okay.
Do I just hit use light side?
Use light side. That's transfer? All you do. Yes.
Okay.
As I said, really nice character sheet. It's the people that have worked on this have done a great job with it, I think. Okay. So you manage to toss a piece of meat right in between the three of them, and they all kind of look up and turn around, and they're munching on it. So they're going to be a little distracted when you initiate your attack. In the meantime, however, you see coming up behind you another three of them.
Of course.
We didn't bring enough jerky.
And these three have spotted you. And we're now going to roll initiative. I'm going to roll two sets of initiative for the Ice Wolves, which we'll get to in a minute. But you should see on the combat section of your screen a box that says initiative. If it's not checked, you're going to need to check it.
I'll show initiative. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And then once you've checked it, what you're going to do is you're going to roll what's called cool. There's two possibilities, cool skill or vigilance. For your initiative, in your case, you're going to roll the cool skill because you're ready for this. You're not totally ready for the ones coming up behind you, but you've got your weapons drawn and you're ready. So you're going to use this cool skill. So everybody, roll on in the initiative section. Roll the cool skill one time. Okay. Now I'm going to roll the initiative for each of these groups of wolves. And for the first group, the one that's up on up above you, the one that you're aware of and that's distracted, I'm going to add two setback die on their initiative because they're distracted by this treat that you've thrown in their midst. And so here we go for them. and they're rolling a skill called Vigilance. All right, so they roll a 1-0, so they were put in the correct slot there. Now, the other set of wolves, they're going to roll cool because they're ready to go. But they don't do very well. They're apparently not very alert. So we're going to have three PC slots at the start, then an NPC, then another PC, and then finally the NPCs. This group, this is actually two groups in the game of what they call minions. Minions attack as a collectively. They don't attack individually. And once you've taken one of them out, any hits that you do on one of them actually get spilt over onto the next one. So they're a little bit better to handle. It makes it much easier if you ever GM this game. It makes it much easier to GM when you've got large numbers of creatures that are attacking in a combat. So we got a PC slot. We're in combat. You've got your distracted wolves up top. You've got your stalking wolves that are coming at you down this other way up the steps, and you're kind of trapped in the middle here.
Do we want to go south first? I would assume.
No, we can't, yeah. Because the guys on the back, they know that we are here, right?
Right, but it makes sense.
If we attack the ones to the south first, they're the ones that are going to come after us.
Yeah. So let's go for the south. I can go melee, and you two guys can be shooting over my shoulder, maybe.
So I guess my concern would be, as soon as combat starts, I guess the noise wouldn't really matter, but like, I thought that maybe shooting at the start might not be a good idea because it would alert the northern ones. But I think that if we're chopping them up, then that would probably make more noise. So,
yeah, and mechanically now they are going to get a turn. I mean, they're going to get a turn when the time comes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Kaveri, do you have melee weapons and stuff like that, or no?
I have fists. So,
all right. I've got the blaster pistol and a lightsaber, so I'll kind of stay with you a little bit, just in case the ones on the top close in, and I can switch to my lightsaber if I need to.
Okay.
And I will hold the back.
I will hold it back as well.
Okay. So who wants to go first?
Shoot. No, maybe Taras and Kaveri can shoot first.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
What does it mean that you have a 2-1? Means that you have an advantage that you can use?
A 2-1, those numbers, that represents that one of the PCs rolled two successes and one advantage mm-hmm. on their initiative check. And that puts them up at the top of the list. You go in the order of the successes that were rolled, and then you break ties with the advantage that are rolled.
Okay.
And then a tie between a PC and an NPC will always favor the PC. We don't have one here, but if... Let's suppose both an NPC and a PC rolled a 1-0. The PC would go before the NPC that rolled a 1-0.
Okay, understood. Okay, so either Kaveri or Taras?
Sure, I'll start. I'll just aim and fire at... Yeah, let's go with the south group.
Okay, the ones that are advancing on you.
Correct.
Okay, those are going to be at medium range, so you're going to roll two purple, mm-hmm. plus you get a blue for a boost for your aim. All right, mm-hmm. so we'll spend the threat before I calculate the damage. The threat will just be taken by Kaveri as a strain, as one strain.
Okay.
And then that's going to do 11 points of damage, which takes out one of them and does some damage to a second one. because this is a minion group, it does a little bit of damage to the second one in that group. So, a very nice shot.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Let's see what a blaster pistol can do.
You are very powerful, actually. I'm very impressed.
Oh, no.
So, did you want to aim? You can do a reroll if you want to aim with a boost.
Yeah, I forgot to put the boost die in. Give it a shot. It's going to be worse. I told you!
So this shot just shoots wildly off into the air, and Tarrasque also takes a strain. He's a little nervous about what's going on right now.
Oh my god.
But we got a third PC that can go now.
I have my lightsaber, so I can move and attack if I want to. Right?
Yes. Yeah, you're going to need two maneuvers, so the first maneuver would get you to about right here. The second maneuver, which you'd have to spend two strain on, can get you to there, but then you would have an attack that you could make at that point.
Can you hold actions in this game?
Yeah, that's what I was wondering, actually.
No, there's no rules for holding actions.
Okay. That's too bad.
Well, since the turn order is not
set. But what Sarinda could do is she could wait and go in the final slot, and there's a good chance that they're going to advance on you before her slot comes up. Right, but Zen's right. That's kind of what the flexible turn order, any PC can take any slot, tries to help you with.
Okay. So I will be the last.
Then I guess I'll actually fight. I'll use my blaster pistol on the wolves we've already done damage to.
Okay. So you're going to take two purple. Do you want to aim? That'll add another blue into it.
So I already have one blue?
Yeah, you get one blue and two purple on this shot. One blue for aiming, two purple for the range.
Here, I will aim. So that's two blue now?
No, just one blue.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then I just roll the weapon one.
Right. Exactly.
Wow.
So Balandi's shot also strays wild, and she takes a strain from her shot.
Shoot.
Is there a mechanical difference between not succeeding and failing?
No.
And not succeeding is still failing.
Yeah.
It's just...
No. There's not. Sometimes the GM might interpret it. I mean, the GM has the discretion to interpret it, any dice roll, and might do something with it like that. But generally, no. If you don't succeed, it's a failure.
Okay.
It's a kind of a binary. All right. So these wolves are going to advance. Up here, they're going to attack Sarinda.
I'm holding my ground.
And
I parry automatically if I want to, no? Or I do it after the attack?
You do it after the attack. They might not do any damage, and then you don't have to parry. So
perfect.
So let's see here.
Okay.
So this is 8 damage. So you're going to begin to calculate your damage by taking 8, and then you're going to take your soak off of it.
And what's that pierce thingy?
Pierce 1 means it goes through one of your soak.
Okay. So I'm going to parry.
Okay. So let's start with calculating the original damage then. What is your soak?
F4.
4. Okay. So you're going to be able to block 3 of that 8, so you take 5, and then if you use the parry ability, you're going to spend 3 strain, and that 3 strain is going to let you reduce the damage from 5 to 2, so you only take 2 damage because you're parrying.
Okay. I just did.
All right, now we've got another PC turn.
So I'm going to attack with my lightsaber.
All right. So you're going to roll. You're going to roll two purple. You can use an aim maneuver on a lightsaber attack as well. So you can roll. You could add a boost die into your attack.
Sure. Let's go. Okay. Here we go. Woo.
So this is a 7, 8, 9 damage, and the lightsaber has a special quality called Breach 1. Breach 1 means it cuts through 1 point of starship armor, and it means it cuts through 10 points of soak. So effectively, you almost always ignore soak with a lightsaber attack. So that's 9 points of damage, and between these two creatures... because they had already taken some damage from the shot earlier, they're both destroyed by Surinda.
There you are.
So they're both defeated.
Yoo-hoo.
And now, this group of ice wolves advances. They have to do one maneuver to get here, and they have to do one maneuver to get to the bottom of the steps, and they have no actions to take because they had to double maneuver to get into range. And that now brings us to the next PC turn.
So if I wanted to stow, equip, and attack with my lightsaber, is that that's two maneuvers and an action?
If you want to drop your weapon, that I'll count that as a free action. And then it would be one maneuver to draw your lightsaber.
Okay. That's what I'm planning on doing, unless anybody else wants to go first.
How does my roll change now that they're in point-blank range?
Now that they're in point-blank range, you're going to roll two purple die. It's what's called engaged, and you roll one in short, you roll for ranged attacks. You roll one in short range, but then when they become engaged, then you go back to rolling two.
Okay.
One question. Can I use this advantage that I got in my attack to reduce one strain or not?
You can't use it to reduce a strain that you took in that same turn.
Okay.
But you could use it for other things like lending a boost to somebody else.
So maybe I'll do that for Tarrasque.
Okay.
Okay.
So what is what is the difficulty?
For Tarrasque's lightsaber attack, it's two purple, and then he gets a boost from Surinda.
Okay. That's all set. Let's see what happens. Well, it hit.
All right, so that's 7 points of damage, which is going to defeat one of these ice wolves and do a little bit of damage to the second one.
Now, they're engaged. Are they only engaged with me or with the group as in general?
They are engaged with Tarrasque and Kaveri right now.
Okay.
Something weird just happened on my screen with Christine.
Her internet went out, and she's back.
All right, we got it. There it goes. It's working now. Okay, we're
good.
Sorry
about that.
Not a problem.
If I take a step back to, like, here, is this far enough that it's short range?
Yes.
Okay, I'll do that and then fire.
Okay. On this shot, I'm going to spend a point from the Destiny pool. And what that's going to do, it's going to upgrade the difficulty of your attack. And so instead of rolling a purple die, you're going to roll a red die.
Okay. Did you use that advantage?
Upgrade your own. No, I'll pass it along. But if you want to spend a destiny point and upgrade your own attack...
I think we're okay, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, we're fine.
So that's 11 points with 2 advantage, minus their soak. Okay, that completely defeats this one. And this one is... I'm sorry, I got that wrong. Yeah, yeah, this one is pretty heavily damaged now, but it's not down yet, this last one.
Okay, and then I'll use an advantage to heal a strain and pass on to the next person.
Okay. And we got one more PC to go before the wolves act.
Belandi, you want to go, or shall I go?
You can go.
I will. Can I use enhance and then attack? My plan is to make a super nice jump. You flip.
Sure.
And then attack with the lightsaber.
Okay. All right. So, yes, I'll let you use the enhance power as a maneuver in this situation. You don't always get to do that, but I'll let you do it in this situation.
That's because it's cool.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so I roll the power.
First you're going to roll the force power for enhance.
Damn it. Right.
Now, to spend a dark side point here, you're going to have to flip a destiny and take two strain. In the actual game, there are even more consequences beyond that. But those are the only you have to take in the beginner game. Those are the only consequences. If you have an option whether you want to spend that or not to use your enhanced power. The force knows that you're trying to showboat here, and doesn't like it.
What should I do, guys?
We have enough light points that I don't like. It's your call. I don't really mind.
Okay, let's do it. It's cool. I'm gonna do it. I don't care. Okay, I use.
Okay.
And then you say I take two strain.
Two strain, and then you can flip in midair and land over here on the steps.
Always attack from the high ground.
Yes, exactly, my father. And then I attack with a lightsaber.
And now on top of this. Because you've got this ice wolf flanked, this is actually something I do that is not set out in the rules. I give you an upgrade on the attack for flanking. So do you see in the on the dice pool over by on the side with the good dice, the blue, green, and yellow, there's an upgrade box. You're gonna hit upgrade one time on this attack.
Okay.
So in addition to your two purple, you get that upgrade, which just increases your lightsaber skill, the effectiveness of it.
Awesome. Okay, so I'm rolling now. Then...
Oof. Not as cool as you thought you were.
That's good. Well, it's a success, I guess, right?
No,
it is not a success because you didn't roll any success. You only get the advantage on that roll.
So no damage or anything to them?
You can spend the advantage to save yourself a strain or to give a boost to the next attacker.
Okay, well, I take down one strain because I'm taking a lot.
Okay.
So four. If you don't mind, guys.
Yeah, that's fine.
Oh. You're distracted.
So now this wolf is down to just scrapping around for survival. It's identified Serinda as a threat with this strange weapon that she's wielding against it. And it's going to lash out. I'm going to spend a dark side point to upgrade this wolf's check as well.
Of course. But that also has a lightsaber. Just saying.
And so here we go with the wolf with one upgrade.
Ooh.
The wolf does 6 damage, pierce 1.
I don't know if this is a thing or not, but can I activate my parry to parry for someone else, or is that just me?
Just for yourself.
Okay.
There's some really cool talents in the game that let you do that, but the parry talent does not.
Okay, so basically one pierce and six. So it takes three, basically.
Yes.
Okay. Done.
All right. And now we've got the, looks like this is the last PC to go.
Yep.
All right, I'm going to fight the last dude with my blaster pistol.
Okay.
Do I need to...
You're in short range, so you're going to have one purple. If you want to aim, you can add one blue for a boost to it.
I will aim.
Another miss, but with plenty of advantage to go with it if you want to spend it.
Could I spend it to try again?
No.
No, okay.
No.
You can get a free maneuver out of it if you want to spend
yeah.
a couple of them.
I don't know what there is that I can do that's helpful at this point.
If you've got strain to recover, you can recover strain with it.
Okay, I'll recover strain then.
Okay.
All one of it.
All right, we're back to the top of the turn order. Any PC can go now.
I want to kill it. Can I go?
Yeah, go for it.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Redeem thyself.
Yes, exactly. So... two purples, and I aim, right? So I can,
right. boost you can it. Take a blue.
And we have extra advantage, right? Because she only used one for a strain?
She can, yeah, Belandi can use her advantage if she wants to give you another boost.
Okay.
I can do that. That's, yeah, I'll do that.
Let's go. Okay, roll high.
There we go.
That will be sufficient to take out the last wolf.
Awesome. And I can reduce one strain with the advantage?
You can recover strain with the advantage, yes.
Thank you.
So the gatekeeper just kind of hovers ahead and says, follow me, we're not far from Malifax now. And heads this way.
Do they look pretty hurt?
Does who look pretty hurt?
Anyone?
I've got two wounds. Serenda's probably worse off.
Hmm.
Yeah, you can. If you want to, you can pause and attempt a heal.
Maybe. Okay.
Do you want me to try to heal you, Serenda?
Yeah.
Okay.
That would be nice.
So would I use my force on that?
You can choose to either use your medicine skill or your force power.
I'll use my force power because that also can equal the amount of strain recovered.
Okay.
Can I just roll, or do I need to roll anything else?
No, just roll the force power. When you use a force power... Oh, yes. Nice.
Yes.
Yay.
Very good.
So this will heal 6 points of damage, and you have the upgrade. Do you have to spend the upgrade to...
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember, you have to spend the upgrade to heal the strain, so you can either heal 3 wounds and 3 strain, or 6 wounds. It's...
6 wounds.
I'll do 6 wounds then. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I feel less.
Is there a limit to how much force power you can use? Can you just keep spamming it every turn, or is there a per day kind of thing for it?
Well, in combat turns, you have to use it for an action. When you're out of combat, it's really up to the GM how often you're allowed to retry using a force power. But. Okay. You know, it's your GM is probably not going to allow you to just repeatedly keep using the heal power when you're out of combat to try to heal. They're probably just going to give you one shot per encounter.
Right.
On it.
Makes sense.
All right, so the gatekeeper leads you on forward to the entrance of the temple. And you come into... an antechamber inside the temple. And from inside the antechamber, you can hear some shouting that's going on inside. There are these large arches and pillars, all this stone decoration everywhere. Much of it's fallen and kind of crumbling. But you can hear this voice echoing through the temple. And the voice is saying, "Nothing. The archive is empty. It's just a bunch of useless scrolls. Where's the holocron?" And then you can hear somebody that you recognize as Hethan Romans, your mentor. You can hear her voice saying, "I don't know. This isn't my place. I can't tell you where it is." He says, "Well, you'd better tell me or I'm going to skin you alive." You're not yet close enough where you're standing right now where you could see what's going on. You can just hear that screaming that's going on.
I think we should go stealthy, guys.
Yeah.
I want to use my force power to see if it's just the two of them.
Okay.
But I won't.
You would not have it been within short range anyway to tell anything. You could have gone up to the door and tried to sense whether there was anything, you know, up to about right here or here. But you couldn't have been able to, you wouldn't have been able to pick up much anyway.
Is the door closed?
The door is open, but you don't see anything through it except, I can reveal a little bit of it there, except kind of a pathway that seems to lead into the temple. And you know what? You can also see from a closer vantage point, you can see on the other side of it, there appears to be some kind of a pit in the center of the temple and a waterfall falling down into it.
Jedi love their water features. So do we want to stealthily approach, get an eye on the situation, see what we can see?
I think we should.
Yeah.
You're able to move up to the door without being detected, and you're able to kind of peek around inside once you get to the door. And what you see is this large chamber, and you see that off to your left there is an adversary that's kind of moving down the steps in your direction, and then up toward the top of it you can see another adversary standing right beside Roman. Roman looks like she's a little rattled. She's been injured, probably not capable of fighting. And then the shouting that you heard, the same voice, it continues to shout similar nonsense. It's coming from a doorway that's located right here.
I say we see if that adversary approaches us so we can take him out quietly.
Yeah, I was just going to say, like, maybe I should stealth up and maybe lightsaber him or something.
I don't want her getting hurt, though.
Well, I can probably take out the one next to her.
And it's possible Serenda could just leap across this.
Of course, I do that every day.
And about this time, Malifax comes back out. He's just continuing to shout and rant, and he just looks like he's getting increasingly angry.
Adversary
is advancing here.
I would say that Tarast and me, we should go melee to get Malifax, and maybe Kaveri and Serenda should take care of the adversaries.
Yeah, do you want to like leap over and protect Roman while I try to take out that adversary and get up to you?
Yeah, and then I'll shoot from behind.
Exactly that.
All right, so let's go ahead and roll for initiative. You all are going to roll cool. I'm going to roll vigilance for all of the other participants.
Not very good.
I'm terrible at initiative.
I did my job.
Yeah, you did, actually. They're missing one, no?
Yeah. We've still got one PC that hasn't rolled an initiative, yeah.
My internet has been really lagging since it cut out.
Well, at least the adversary's terrible too. Oh, but a triumph on Malifax.
Can I repeat my initiative? Because I had all the boost and all the stuff. Sorry. I didn't realize.
You had some other stuff in your pool, yeah. So the original one that you rolled was the 2, the 0, 3.
No, 0, 1 or 0, 3, yeah. 0, 3.
Okay. All right, so now I've got... I'm still missing a PC, though.
I need to roll. Because
oh, yeah, I'm sorry, re-roll, yeah. 3-1, okay.
Much better, nice.
Because I have a very high initiative, so I was like, what?
So we have 2 3-1s from the PCs? Yeah, we do. Belandi got a 3-1. Okay. So we've got 2 PC slots before the NPCs can act.
So how do we do this? Should I go ahead and jump and be there? And then
do we have like advantage for surprise?
Yeah.
No. You're just gonna have to act in these slots. The initiative. You've got pretty good initiative on this though.
Yeah. So I would say maybe.
Yeah. Go ahead.
No. You go ahead.
So I think. If combat breaks out, we're going to have to protect Roman. Like that is the priority here. So I think, Serenda, you go first and get over there as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm.
I almost want to say, Kaveri, shoot the advisee here second.
Yeah, I think so too.
And then Belandi and I can figure out stuff with NPCs moving around after that.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. Like, make us more of a threat so that they can't think about killing her.
Okay, so we'll move towards here and then leap.
Alright, so you're going to spend one maneuver to get here, and then you're going to spend an action to try to leap to about right here. That action is going to be a roll on your force power.
Yes, exactly. So, okay, I'm rolling. Use your fingers.
Yes.
There you are.
So Serenda leaps across over here. They're all just kind of looking at her, stunned, having all of a sudden charged in. Now, you're not engaged. I'm going to move you back just a little bit.
Okay.
You're not engaged with that adversary right now, but you're very close to them. And they have no idea what's going on here.
Which, if I remember correctly, is a good thing, because shooting into engagement is bad for the shooter.
Yeah, right? That's kind of what I assume.
Yep. All right, so next PC.
No, that's fine. I'll just aim and shoot at the adversary.
Okay.
The one next to Remond.
So that's going to be one blue, and then you are at long range, so that's actually going to be 3 purple.
Upgrade it.
We believe in you.
You can use a destiny point to upgrade it if you want to.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Oh, geez.
Nice.
All right, so you're going to take a couple of strain from the threat that you rolled on that.
Mm-hmm.
And this adversary just goes down. I mean, boom.
Boom.
And now you've got a triumph. You can make something really nice happen on top of the shot that you just took with that triumph.
What do we got for options here?
So upgrade any allied characters, nice check.
You can upgrade somebody's check that's coming up for one thing. You can create an environmental condition that would be favorable for you as a result of the shot. Those would be two possibilities.
Can you make the floor by Malifax slippery so he falls over?
Can I shoot a pillar so that it falls on him?
That's the one. Yeah, that's the one. I like that.
Sure. Okay. So a pillar kind of comes loose as a result of the shot echoing off, and it kind of comes down on top of him, and he takes some wounds from that. And now Malifax says, who are you? What are you doing here? And he pulls out this really wicked-looking sword and runs right up where he's adjacent to Sarinda. And he's going to attack her.
Okay. I'm ready. And Raw Moon's protectors.
Dun, dun, dun. He kind of swings wildly, and she's able to kind of duck and weave and miss it. But he rolls a couple of advantage from that, and that he's going to use that advantage for when this adversary over here attacks. So he's going to boost that adversary's attack. And now we're back to a PC slot.
Okay. Belandi, did you have anything you wanted to do first?
I say I could try to shoot, but you know I miss, so it's probably better if you go.
All right. I'm going to... Is there any advantage to sneaking around the corner and hitting the adversary, or should I just run up and hit him?
There's not any advantage to using stealth. You can just run up and hit him just as well.
Okay, then that's what I'm going to do. I'll run up and flick on my lightsaber as I run up and do an upward swing, see if I can take him out.
Okay, very good.
That's two purple die?
Two purple, yeah.
Okay. And no advantage on this. Let's just see how it goes. No.
So
horrible failures.
So it's a whiff on that adversary. And we got one last PC slot here.
Okay. Medium range. Am I close enough to do anything to anybody, or do I need to move?
Do like what?
Damage to the adversary close to us. Or
You could attack him at medium range.
Sure.
With two purple and an aim, if you want to, a boost aim.
Sure, I'll do that.
If you move up, it'll only be one purple.
Okay.
Just say.
But it also removes the boost.
Yeah, I think I'll stick with the boost just in case.
There we go.
Nice.
That does 7 points of damage to the adversary. Which does injure him a little bit.
Great.
So he's hit for sure by that attack. And now he's going to scramble back just a couple of steps, and after he scrambles back, he's going to take aim at Tarrasque with a blaster. He's not aiming, I'm sorry. He's shooting at Tarrasque with a blaster. He is not aiming. Correction on that. He takes a strain from his shot.
Did he get his upgrade? From Malifax? Malifax upgraded him.
Oh, right.
That's right. Okay, let's re-roll that.
Sorry, guys, I know. Same team.
He got a boost and not an upgrade, but yes, we'll re-roll that with that boost.
Okay, it was the boost. Yep.
Yeah. So he's going to do 7 points. 7 points of damage minus soak.
Okay, so I soak 2. That's 5. I will parry for three more, which brings it down to two.
Okay. And then, of course, you take three strain with that as well. And that brings us back to the top of combat round.
Lightsabers go, I think, for...
Yeah, for surrender, get in there.
Okay. So I swing at the Malifax guy.
Okay, you're engaged. You can use an aim with it as well. And mm-hmm. Always a melee attack is two purple. But you know okay. what? In this case, I'm going to use a dark side point. And so that's going to make it one purple and one red instead. It upgrades the check.
Okay, that's fine. You shall fall. Let's go.
Nice.
Okay.
Serena's going to take a couple of strain with this attack. And Malifax is going to use his parry ability to get rid of three of that nine, but he's still taking six.
Boom.
So you kind of have an exchange between your blades there, and he's kind of knocked back a little bit. And combat continues with another PC slot.
Advise down. Got a bunch of light side points, so I'm going to upgrade...
Sure.
And I set it to right now. Okay. What the hell?
Another mess, but with some advantage to spend.
Yep, I will heal a strain and pass one along.
Okay, so the next PC that attacks will get a boost die. And now Malifax is facing Serinda here. He's going mm-hmm. to spend another dark side point, which is going to upgrade his check. And he's taking an aim. So let's make sure I've got everything right. Taking an aim, that gives him a boost die, and here we go.
Okay.
Should be worse.
This will do 6 points of damage. It pierces through two of your soak.
We'll use parry.
Okay. So first we calculate the damage. So yeah. that would be six minus what?
Three.
That's pierce two. With a pierce two, you've got five soak.
I have four soak. That means only two.
Right, exactly. So it'll be six minus two is four. Then with your parry, you only take one wound. Three strain only take one wound.
Yeah. I'm tired.
All right, so Serinda's holding off Malifax so far while you all try to get up to her. And we're back to a PC.
I have one boost because we had a spare advantage, right?
I believe that's right. Yeah, from Terrest's attack. So this shot just misses with some advantage, but it just misses. Zips by his ear.
I'm sad. That's my first miss. And then take a shot on Malifax.
Okay, that'll be a shot at medium range for two purple.
Okay. Do I have another penalty because they're engaged?
No, there's no penalty because they're engaged. If you roll a despair, it'll hit Serinda, but there's no risk of that with two purple. But okay. In the game, if you were rolling any red on this, then you'd be at risk of hitting her.
Okay, and I have one boost because we had a spare advantage, right?
I believe that's right. Yeah, from Terrest's attack. So this shot just misses with some advantage, but it just misses. Zips by his ear.
I'm sad. That's my first miss.
Can't win them all, man.
Yeah. With three advantage, can he still negate enemy defenses and such? Or does it have to hit in order to do that?
No, you could negate enemy defenses with that.
Do you think that's more valuable than a boost die?
But in this case, though, he's not in cover. He doesn't have any defensive bonuses right now.
Okay, that's not soak or anything.
No.
All right.
It's a defensive bonus that you can get a defensive bonus in the game, which gives him automatic setback die, like armor would do that, for example. Being in cover does that. But he doesn't have any defensive bonuses in the position he's in right now, so that it would make sense to do that.
Okay.
Well, it says with three advantage, I can force the target to drop the weapon it's wielding.
Yes, you can do that.
Okay, nice. I'll do that. Make him drop a sword.
So your shot goes off his arm and his sword falls down behind him. Nice. He doesn't do any damage, but he has been disarmed for the moment. And
should we yell to Roman to get the sword?
Unfortunately, she's immobilized, but yeah.
Oh, okay.
All right, so next PC.
So I tell him, stand down or you will die.
I think we've got Balandi's slot still to go.
Yeah. Sorry. Okay. I thought we were the new one.
Does anybody need healing right now, or could I attack?
Pour it on. Just keep hitting people.
Okay. Can I aim and attack the adversary down here, or am I too far?
You would have to move into the doorway right there. You'd have to maneuver. And then once you've maneuvered into the doorway, you would have used one maneuver. You can spend strain for another maneuver. You can spend two strain to give you the boost, or you can just roll against the two purple without a boost.
Now I'll give myself a boost, so I'm spending two strain on that.
Okay.
And all right, let me give myself blue.
Oof. This adversary is worst.
Yeah.
Wow, he is able to duck and dodge and avoid you guys.
And he's better than Malifax. Why isn't he in charge?
He's going to stumble back again and fire his weapon again at Tarrasque.
I haven't done anything to you.
Come in peace.
Damn.
Eight damage minus soak to Tarrasque. He does take a strain.
That's six. I'm going to have to spend three more strain. Knock it down to three.
So the blaster bolt fires at Tarrasque, and Tarrasque puts his lightsaber in front of it and reflects it back. And do you have the reflect ability, Tarrasque?
It's just parry.
It's parry, okay. Ordinarily, we'll go ahead and do it this way this time. Ordinarily, parry only applies to melee attacks. There's another talent.
Oh, I didn't notice that.
Well, you probably seen Surinda doing it because Surinda has both reflect and parry.
Okay.
But we'll go ahead and we'll do it this way this time, so we don't have to go back and undo anything. But ordinarily, that's only if there's a melee attack that you can use that.
Okay, I will keep that in mind.
Okay, so now we've got another PC, but we're back to the top, so any PC can go.
So I'm gonna tell Aleph, down or you will die.
Right. So you got a coercion ability?
I do. I think. Yes, I can roll it. I'm not very good, but.
All right. So you're gonna roll coercion, and you're gonna roll that against. Let me tell you what. Give me a second to find that. Mm-hmm. You're gonna roll coercion against. Two purple dice.
But he's also disarmed.
And because he is disarmed, he is going to Also, you're going to be able to add 2 boost die to that because he's disarmed. He's in an unfavorable situation.
Use a destiny point.
Yeah. To upgrade. And I upgrade to 1, right?
Yeah, so now you upgrade 1, yes.
Okay, so I'm rolling. Cause fingers.
So that speech cost you a maneuver. You still have an action. He says, never!
Then die! Damn! Damn it. Okay. Just attack then.
So that's 7, 8, 9. He's gonna try to parry that.
With what?
Can he parry with nothing?
Can he parry? Oh, that you're right. He can't parry. Sorry about that. He's just gonna take it. So that's 9 points, and she kind of slashes through him on the right side. He kind of falls off into the pool that's on his left. And he goes washing off down the waterfall and screaming, and then dragged off into a torrent to a death in the depths of the springs that are below the Jedi Temple. And this adversary kind of says, kind of panics and just goes running out. You're never going to see it again now that it's seen what's happened there. And so I'm going to take you back out of combat now. And Hetha says to you, friends, I was worried that my message would not have reached you. I only had moments when he took me. I've never been happier to see you than I am right now.
We are happy to see you too.
The gatekeeper.
I don't know her.
The gatekeeper comes in and he says, indeed, your students have done very well. They passed this test well.
Test?
Should we be worried about the guy who fell down the waterfall?
No, he's been defeated. I should have mentioned that. Mechanically, he's been defeated. All of the rest of it was just drama to make it more interesting. Yeah, what you can ask the GM if you're not sure if somebody's dead, what you can ask the GM to make sure they've been taken care of is you can ask, have they been defeated? And they should tell you that, but he has been defeated in this situation. And so he can't pose a threat in this combat. He could come back again later and cause you problems, but he's gone for now.
Okay.
Yeah. So can we untie Roman?
Yes, you can untie Roman.
Okay. So we do that.
And then the gatekeeper says, I'd like to get you to help me with one more thing. This temple's been corrupted because Malifax has been in here with all of his minions. If you would, could you all sit down over here beside me? And I want to instruct you in a way where we can try to purge this temple from the dark side.
Is there a skill to tell if he has any ill intent? Because ever since the ice pit, I'm not super trusting of this guy.
Yeah, you could roll. You can sense. In typically a living thing, you couldn't use the sense ability because he's a non-living thing. But in this case, because he's kind of imbued with the force, I'll let you use your sensibility on him to move within short range. So you can.
I'll use the light side and the strain.
Okay. So no, you don't sense any anything malicious at all from the gatekeeper.
Okay. Then I'll do what he says.
Okay.
Yeah.
Being strained and wounded, I will gladly go sit down anywhere.
So you all sit down with him and Romand, and now you're all going to make rolls with one force die. Just go up in the pool and roll one force die using your force ability.
Okay. Okay.
You have to remove the focus, yeah.
Ah, okay. Okay. Boom.
And we're missing a Blondie.
Yeah, Blondie. Sorry. That's all right.
No problem.
Ah, he means. I know.
Which one is that to roll again?
So the middle dice in the dice pool is the force die. Just roll one of those. That's all you're going to roll.
Okay.
And then I will roll one for... For Romand, she actually is going to roll two. She has a force rating of two.
Whoa.
Ooh. Kill her. She's a Sith.
but we do get enough light side points there that you're successful in this ritual, and you're able to assist the gatekeeper in ridding the temple of any of the bad influences that would have been imposed on it by Malifax. And with that, your adventure ends. Ordinarily, what I do at this point is award experience. You would normally get an additional 10 points of experience as a result of this that you could spend on your characters. Unfortunately, because this is not a game that's going to go on, there's not a whole lot of purpose in getting it. But you can at least celebrate a job well done on this.
High fives, team.
Yeah, it was very good, actually. I really like it. Mm-hmm. Although it's a little bit hard to share the dice, I think. How to interpret them.
Yeah.
It's pretty different.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not as it's designed to add more of a narrative element and a little less of a mechanical element. So it's not, it's a little more squishy, a little less crunchy, if you want to put it that way. But it still does have a bit of a crunchy element to it. That's what I like, is it's not so far off base that you don't have any kind of numbers that you use to deal with some things like wounds and some things like that. So
is the distribution on all the dice like even?
Yes, all green dice are you asking if all green dice, for example, are identical?
No, I'm asking if like on a normal D6, you have 1 through 6, right?
Right.
But on this, you could have like two successes on two sides and like one success on two sides and then nothing on the other two sides.
Right, exactly. Like for example, I'm looking at a green dice right now. It has one blank side. It has a success and advantage. It has a one success. It has a two success. It has a variety of different results on it. Only a yellow one gives you the triumph. Only if you roll a yellow die do you get a triumph. So that's another reason you want to try to get those upgrades and skill ranks in on those checks, is because that gives you the potential for the triumph, which can really make a difference for you. Over time, you've got the ability to increase your force power. When you do, that adds to the number of dice that you roll in your force pool. And so if you roll two dice, that doubles your chances of getting a light side result and also increases the number of pips that you can spend. Bolt.
Nice.
Very cool. Well, thank you for running this. I appreciate
thank
it.
You.
It's a really good overview of the system. I'm definitely going to play this in the future.
Yeah, guys, this was great fun. You were a fantastic group. Absolutely creative and some really nice tactical decisions that I thought you made along the way to kind of optimize everybody's ability. So I had a lot of fun playing with you. I'm gonna go ahead and shut off the Twitch stream now. Thanks to anybody or everybody that's left that's been watching. We're glad you were with us. And I will be back with the Wayward Spirit campaign next Thursday night at 7:30 for anybody that's interested in it.